Good morning. Welcome to Hope Church. Thanks so much for hopping online and joining us today. We have a chance to connect with God and other people online today. And that actually might be perfect for those of you who don't like singing in public spaces. Today, you just get to crank up the volume and sing it out as loud as you can. So I encourage you to do that. And please stay on this stream for the entire experience today. We're going to be telling you what to expect from Hope Church here over the next few weeks in a little bit. But first, we're going to get started just by singing a couple songs together. So let's get to it. Here we go. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty? So much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless and all in wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Sing, this is amazing grace. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. That you've done for me. Yeah, that's it. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered. My place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Well, hey, if you're just joining us here on the Hope Church live stream, I want to welcome you guys. Thanks so much for hopping online and joining us today. I'm gonna encourage you to stay online today for the whole stream, as we're gonna be telling you what to expect over the next few weeks from Hope Church. And we're gonna hear an awesome message in response to the things going on in our world today. Now, but right now, let's sing this next song together. Darkness tries to rule over my bones. When sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know. No, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to the light. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. No, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance. Thank you so much for worshiping with us today. Hey, for all the families out there who are missing Kids Connect this morning, we're going to take a moment and hear from our children's ministry director, Kathy.
Thank you, Nathan. Good morning, everyone. Parents, the coronavirus and staying home from school to keep ourselves and others healthy really reminds us that sometimes it's difficult to talk to our kids about challenging things, and sometimes even about God. That's why we have some online resources to support you in that. Kids, even though nothing could replace meeting together in person, we made some video lessons for you. So encourage your adults to head on over to the Hope Lake Country website and go to the kids page where you'll find that. That link will be posted in the chat box. adults, also on our Hope Lake Country Kids page, you're going to find resources about how to have hard conversations with kids of all ages, which is great because it applies to our parenting really in all seasons of life. Also on the Hope website, we update our Sunday morning family handouts every week as well. So families, you are the most important influence in your child's life. We'll be praying for you as you lead your families to Jesus every day of the week, not just on Sundays. And since most of us are going to have some extra special family time coming up in the near future, let's take advantage of that gift of time to really lead our families well. Thank you for the privilege to be in this with you. Growing closer to God with your family is really going to help you all grow closer to each other as well. Thanks so much for being online to stay in touch with your church family during this time. We can do this, and we love you guys.
Man, that is so true what Kathy said about taking advantage of this time, especially if you have family. Thanks for joining us online today. If you're new, my name is Jason. I'm the lead pastor here at Hope Church. And whether you're watching alone or have a small watch party, man, thanks for being here. And the reason why I'm glad you're here is because I think the best place to turn in a season like this is to God and to the Word of God so that His wisdom and His love can be the thing that guides us during a challenging season of life. I hope you'll also stay tuned right up to the end because at the end we'll be giving some announcements about what you can expect from Hope Church over the coming weeks during this very uncertain time. Well, this has definitely been one of the most bizarre weeks of our lifetime in our generation. One of the strangest weeks I think we've ever gone through as a society. And we've seen a lot of panic as a result of what we're seeing. The number of infected is growing every day. The number of closures and cancellations is growing here in Wisconsin, as well as many other states. All K through 12 schools have been closed at least for 3 weeks, and that could be extended further. We've seen colleges and universities going to virtual classes only for the rest of the semester. Grocery store shelves are empty. Childcares are closing. It's just a weird and unprecedented time. And as a result of that, I don't know what you're experiencing out there, but I've bumped into people feeling all kinds of very powerful emotions that have come up to the surface. For example, many people right now are worried when they see this pandemic spreading. They're worried about their own health. They're worried about the health of a loved one, particularly if they're older or if they have some kind of compromised immune system and they're worried because of that. Or if you're not worried about your health, perhaps you're worried about the economy or your livelihood or finding childcare, or maybe you're just worried about having kids home for a 3 week long spring break now. But worry is one of the emotions that people are feeling right now and struggling with. Some people are struggling with anxiety right now. It's kind of that generalized worry because every time you turn the television on, every time you open your phone, every time you strike up a conversation with someone, the topic that everyone's talking about is the coronavirus. And in fact, some people, because of anxiety, are intentionally going onto their news feed way more frequently than they ever would because they don't want to be surprised by the bad news. They want to see it as it's coming and understand what's going on. A lot of people out there are struggling with the emotion of anger right now. Some people are angry at elected officials, thinking they're not doing their job as well as they should. Some people are angry at China, saying they didn't do their job and they're not being transparent. Some people are angry at the media, saying this whole thing is being over-sensationalized and that's making things worse. Some people, they're just angry. They don't even know who they're angry at. They're angry at coronavirus because it is totally impeding on our lives right now. And I know a good number of people in the state of Wisconsin are angry at Rudy Gobert for single-handedly bringing the Bucks season of destiny to an end. A lot of people out there aren't angry as much as they're shocked at everything that's happening. It's hard to believe it was only 4 days ago when many of us were shocked to hear the news that the NCAA was canceling all fans being allowed at NCAA tournament games. And we thought to ourselves, how can you have March Madness without any fans in the building? But that was just like a first domino and everything after it began to fall. And within 48 hours, every major sporting event, every season was either canceled or at least suspended indefinitely. And the shock of all of that, the shock of schools being closed and of countries going on lockdown and borders being closed, so the primary emotion some people are feeling is just shock at all of this. I'm also bumping into a lot of people who are feeling disappointment, because unfortunately, events like this can really bring out the worst in people. And when you go to the grocery store and you see empty shelves, you're kind of disappointed that even though there's no disruption to supply chain for things like food, people are really turning to selfish ends and not caring about their community, but just living only for themselves and hoarding goods for themselves. And yesterday in our pre-marriage class, we were talking through all of this, and what we surfaced was an emotion that I hadn't necessarily thought of right away, but right now you're probably feeling grief or the need to grieve. You see, we need to grieve in life whenever we experience a loss of any sort, and those can be of varying magnitudes, of course. But if you had season tickets to the Brewers, or you had tickets at least to opening day, and you lost the ability to go on opening day, that's a loss, and we have to grieve our losses to be healthy people. Or maybe you had a spring break trip to Disneyland planned, and now that's a loss, and you have to grieve or mourn that loss. We've had such a compact season of losses, we haven't even had a chance to grieve these small losses along the way, and that kind of builds up inside of us and creates a powerful emotion. And I don't know which of these emotions you've been feeling this week, or maybe there's even been other ones, but something that we're probably all feeling right now is an element of frustration. Because no matter what you're feeling and what your particular situation is, the reality is, there's not much you can do about it. There's not much you can do about coronavirus. I mean, you can wash your hands and you can socially isolate and you can pray, but make sure you wash your hands before you pray because they're probably covered in virus. But that's all you can do is just sit at home. And we're being told by our officials and by the experts, that's the way that you help. Sit at home for 3 or more weeks, perhaps socially isolate as much as you can. And for many of us, that's frustrating because it feels like there's nothing that we can do. So my question for you today is, what do you do when you're frustrated? What do you do when you're stuck? What do you do when you're in a situation where, quite frankly, there's not much you can do? See, all of us have to wrestle with that question, not just in our community, not just in our state, not just in our nation. All the citizens of the world need an answer to this question right now. What do you do when you're stuck? What do you do when there just isn't very much that you can do? Because until you deal with that frustration, it's going to be really challenging to handle some of those other emotions that we're feeling. So that's what I want to talk about today. Now, 3 days ago, our staff decided we were going to cancel our live gathering this weekend. And we also decided that we're going to completely scrap all of the plans that we had for this Sunday. We were supposed to start a new series today called Altered, and we're going to be looking at the suffering and death of Jesus. Our intention is to begin that series next Sunday, not live, not in the room, but here online, digitally streaming it. But today, I wanted to just address what it is that we're all going through right now with the coronavirus and struggling with that. And my challenge today as a pastor wasn't, you know, finding something to say, like, what do I say in a season like this? The challenging thing was sorting through all the dozens of Bible verses I could have spoken on today. Because while this week was new for us and while it was bizarre for us, it certainly isn't new in the history of the world. People have been dealing with challenges and pandemics and fearful situations since about the dawn of time. And what's happening certainly isn't a surprise to God. He has led people through seasons like this before. So there are just so many scriptures we could have spoken about this morning. For example, when I first started this message, I thought, you know, we're going to talk about Psalm 46 today. It's worth reading. It's worth thinking about. But Psalm 46 says that God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. See, no matter what's going on, we're not going to fear if we take refuge in God. Because if we're hiding within God, if we're taking refuge within God, He is stronger than anything we're facing, so we can be confident. If we let Him be our strength, we don't need to fear what's going on around us. And later in the psalm, God says this to us. He says, "Be still and know that I am God." See, our challenge right now is you have to be still. We have to socially isolate. But if we just leave it at that, we have all these emotions like frustration. But if you decide to be still and know that God is God, that we are in His hands, that He is with you, that He is for you, He will lead us through this, that allows us to be still in His presence, and that changes everything. And I thought, man, that'd be the perfect thing to talk about with coronavirus. But then I changed my mind. I thought, no, what if I did something more familiar? What if I went to Psalm 23? In Psalm 23, we're told, the Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. Because if God is your shepherd, then He really is always leading you to green pastures. And if He's your shepherd, then everything's going to be okay. But in the end, what I decided to do was I didn't want to interrupt what our church has already been doing. And if this is your first time checking out Hope, or if this is your first time with us in a while, what our church has been doing is in the 90 days leading up to Easter, we've been working through the life of Jesus, both in my preaching and also in the church. We had a 90-day reading plan, and if you do a 90-day reading plan, it takes about 5 minutes a day to read through the entire life of Jesus. So that's been helpful for people. But every Sunday morning, I've been preaching out of one of the four biographical accounts we have of the life of Jesus in the New Testament. And I thought, I think it's important leading up to Easter, since it's only 28 days away, that we continue doing that. So I decided to look at something from the life of Jesus. And so today what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at a biographical account of the life of Jesus written by a man by the name of Mark. And what Mark writes about one particular episode from the life of Jesus, it tells us what to do, and it informs us what to do when life rattles our confidence. When life rattles our confidence in us, when life rattles our confidence in God, or our confidence that God actually is who He says He is and He will do everything He's promised to do. And the reason why I chose this account is not only does it speak to that, but in my opinion, it's one of the most powerful and tender moments that we find from Jesus in His entire ministry. So if you want to read it at home, you can. The words will be on the screen. We're going to be in Mark chapter 5, beginning at verse 21, where we're told, "When Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, so what had preceded this was Jesus was in a boat on the Sea of Galilee with His disciples, and a furious storm came up, and they thought they would drown, they thought they would die, the storm was that violent, and Jesus rebuked the storm, and the water became glass calm. So that's what had just happened. They crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake. A large crowd gathered around Him while He was by the lake. Then one of the synagogue leaders, named Jairus, came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at His feet." Now, a synagogue leader would have been someone who was a good man, a religious man, a respected leader in the community, probably a business owner, probably very generous in the community. So the synagogue ruler, the leader, was someone that is a good guy. People respected him and followed his leadership. He came and he found Jesus. He fell at His feet, and here's what he did. He pleaded earnestly with Him, "My little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live." So Jesus went with him. Now, the language here really tells us that what Jairus is saying to Jesus is, "Jesus, I have a little girl at home, and she's as good as dead." And if you're a parent and you've ever had a child who's sick, you know how frantic and heartbroken and urgent you can be in a situation like this. What we know from Jairus is that he loved his daughter very much, and he would have exhausted any means necessary to heal her. He would have gone through the doctors. He would have done whatever he could, but still, she's getting sicker, and she is at death's door. So in a last-ditch effort, he hears that Jesus is nearby. He goes out. He leaves his dying daughter to go out and find Jesus and urgently plead with Him for help, and Jesus says, "Let's go." Now imagine what he would have felt in that moment. Jairus is like, "I'm frantic, it's urgent. Jesus agreed to help. Maybe there's hope for my daughter." And urgently they turn, and he starts to lead Jesus back to his home. Now a large crowd followed because they overheard all this commotion. They're like, "Hey, Jesus is going to help this guy. Maybe we're going to see a miracle today." So they wanted to see. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. years. So there's a woman in the crowd. She's had a chronic condition with some sort of internal bleeding. Scholars mostly think this had to do with her reproductive system. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. Yet, instead of getting better, she grew worse. It's interesting that Mark gives this detail that she wasn't just treated by many doctors, she suffered under the care of many doctors. So she had this condition which made her life miserable and painful, and all the treatment she got from doctors ended up just being more suffering. So you've got Jairus, who is absolutely stuck. He can't do anything to help his daughter. There's nothing he can do. And now you've got this woman who has exhausted every possible avenue to get better, but it's only made things worse and worse, and she spent her last dollar and there's nothing she can do. Two people who are stuck, two people that can do nothing to help their situations. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Immediately her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body she was freed from her suffering. So the crowd is pressed in all around Jesus. This woman thinks, if I can just sneak past the bouncer and if I can just touch the edge of his clothing, I'm sure that will heal me. So she sneaks up, she touches him, and instantly in her bones, she knows it worked. She has been instantly healed from this chronic condition that has plagued her for the last 12 years. Verse 30. At once, Jesus realized, this is interesting because this is the only place in the life of Jesus something like this is mentioned. At once, Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" "You see the people crowding against you," his disciples answered, "and yet you can ask, 'Who touched me?'" But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. So as soon as this woman touches Jesus, he recognizes something fascinating. He has grown weaker. He grew weaker and this woman grew stronger. She was healed, but he had to lose power. He had to give up power, and he knew right away, just like she knew right away she was healed, he knew right away, I have been weakened by this. And he becomes absolutely adamant about stopping everything to find out, who was it that did this? Who was it that touched me? The disciples, of course, are baffled. They're like, Jesus, there are hundreds of people in this crowd. Everyone is brushing up against everyone. This is like Costco on Saturday afternoon of coronavirus weekend. Okay, everyone's here. How can you stop the ambulance to ask who touched you? Verse 33. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet, and trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. Now, why is she so afraid? Well, according to Hebrew ceremonial law, if she had blood flow, she was ceremonially unclean. And if anyone touched someone who had blood flow, they would become unclean. And so for a woman to have the audacity to do this to a man and to make an esteemed rabbi become unclean, that was a massive cultural faux pas. She could have been scorned. She could have been disciplined. She could have been ostracized. So trembling in fear, she falls at his feet and tells him the whole truth. And look how Jesus responds so tenderly. He said to her, "Daughter," to this woman who's likely older than he is, "daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." Daughter, go in faith. Or go in peace, your faith has healed you. And we read that and we say, how wonderful, how nice, how irresponsible. Think about it. This man's daughter is dying at home. She has an acute condition, and Jesus stops everything. She's already better. She's fine, Jesus. Just keep going on your way. She's taken care of. But he has to stop everything to have a side conversation with this woman. This would be like an ambulance en route to a heart attack victim stopping along the way to help someone with a broken arm. Okay, if this was an emergency room and these two people were at the ER and a doctor treated this woman before the little girl, he would be sued for malpractice. Jesus is committing malpractice. That's how strange this would have been to the people in the crowd. And imagine Jairus at this point. He's holding on to his last thread of hope, saying, "Hurry, Jesus, hurry. She's home. She's about to die. If you hurry, maybe there's still hope. Hurry, Jesus, hurry." But Jesus will not be hurried. There's nothing Jairus can do, but Jesus will not be hurried. He decides he's going to stop everything to talk to this woman who's already received her healing. And while Jairus is anxiously waiting, he gets the bad news. While Jesus was still speaking, some people came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. "Your daughter is dead," they said. "Why bother the teacher anymore?" And I wonder if there is derision in that last statement. Why? Apparently he's too important to be bothered. Why bother him anymore? There wasn't anything we can do, but he didn't feel the need to come through and help us. He got the worst possible news in that moment. And right as his heart was sinking, and as he would have been sinking into despair, here's what Jesus did. Overhearing what they said, Jesus told him, "Don't be afraid. Just believe. Don't be afraid. Don't lose your hope. Don't lose your trust. Don't give way to fear. Don't be afraid. Just believe." Because God's sense of timing, God's sense of showing up is seldom aligned with our sense of showing up. The way we want God to come through is seldom aligned with how God intends to come through on our behalf. And Jesus looks at Jairus and he says to him, "Hey, trust me, don't lose your hope yet, don't lose your faith yet, be patient, because I'm telling you that my grace and my love are 100% compatible with what seemed to you like negligence and absence from me." See, Jesus isn't saying to him, "Jairus, I will not be hurried even though I love you." What Jesus is saying to Jairus is, "Jairus, look at me. I will not be hurried because I love you. Because I am going to do something that is beyond what you are asking, but I need you to continue to trust in me." Verse 37. He did not allow anyone follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. Those are his disciples. When they came to the home of the synagogue leader, Jesus saw a commotion, with people crying and wailing loudly. He went in and said to them, "Why all this commotion and wailing? The child is not dead, but asleep." But they laughed at him. And of course they did. This would be like walking in to a funeral home and saying that the deceased is only taking a nap. It's as laughable as it is ignorant as it is completely inappropriate. After he put them all out, he took the child's father and mother and the disciples who were with him and went in where their little child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha koum," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, get up." And now we come to the climax of the story. Immediately, the girl stood up and began to walk around. She was 12 years old. At this, they were completely astonished. And I wrote in my notes, "I bet they were completely astonished." Now, there's so much going on in this account that I skipped over. But I think for our purposes, there's a couple of important things that if we see them and take them to heart, they're going to give us hope as we deal with our present reality. And the first big idea I want you to see today is this. When you go to Jesus, he might ask for more than you plan to give. Okay? When you go to Jesus, very often he will ask for more from you than you planned to give to him. Look at the people in the story. Jairus went to Jesus, and what he hoped to give him was just enough trust and just enough time for Jesus to heal his daughter. The woman went to Jesus And she hoped to keep her anonymity, but what she hoped to give him was just a touch, just enough trust to touch him and run. I'm better. I'm out of here. Simple as that. But Jesus wouldn't have it. She wanted to give him just a little touch on the side of his clothes, but Jesus said, no, I'm going to ask you for more than you wanted to give. I'm going to ask you to go public. I'm going to ask you to be recognized. And for Jairus, he said, no, I'm not going to ask for just enough trust to heal your daughter. After your daughter has died, I'm going to ask you for something more than you planned on giving me, even more trust than you planned on giving me. Why would Jesus do that? The reason why Jesus asked for more than they wanted to give was because he planned on giving them more than they had hoped to receive. You see, this woman just wanted a healing, but Jesus wanted to give her an eternal life. He wanted to give her a relationship with him forever. He wanted to give her a new eternal destination, and that was worth stopping for, so that she understood this was not some kind of superstitious thing or hocus pocus thing. This was your faith in me, the Son of God, who has come to earth to save the world, that you were healed, and you need to understand that. That's why he thought it was worth stopping to talk to this woman, because he wanted to give her more than she wanted to receive. She wanted a healing, he wanted to give her eternal life. And the same thing for Jairus. All he wanted from Jesus was a miracle. All he wanted from him was a healing, but Jesus planned to give him more than a miracle and more than a healing. Jesus intended to give him a resurrection. You see, for Jesus, giving a cure for a fever or giving a resurrection is really no big deal. It's about the same, but it meant everything for Jairus. And that's what we see in this account, that when you go to Jesus, he might ask for more than you plan to give, but when you go to Jesus, he will give more than you planned to receive. So what does that mean for us right now? As we're waiting, there's nothing we can do, or there's not much we can do, and we're feeling frustrated, and there's all these other emotions as our entire world is dealing with this pandemic. Well, the first thing is to be aware of these two principles. That when you go to God and you ask him for help in your situation, he might ask you to give more than you had planned to give. Perhaps he's going to ask you to give more trust than you had anticipated or wanted to. Perhaps he's going to ask you to give more tears than you wanted to. Perhaps he's going to ask you to give more of your time than you had ever wanted to. Because sometimes Jesus asks us to give more than we had intended, but Jesus always intends to give more than you planned on receiving. Well, how can we be sure of this? I mean, you say, yeah, that's a nice story. I'm glad it worked out for everyone in the end with this woman and with Jairus and with his daughter. But how can we be sure of this? I mean, that was so long ago. How do we know this still applies to us? Well, if you look carefully at this entire text, there are two huge truths hidden right there in plain sight. And I just want to show you what they were. The first was in the fact that Mark made a point of telling us that power had gone out from Jesus. Now, why did he tell us that? The reason why is because he's showing us that this is the principle of how the entire gospel works. See, we in our sin are far away from God and broken. And the only way for us to be returned to God and have eternal life and have a relationship with him forever is for Jesus to become weak, for Jesus to bear our sin, for Jesus to trade places with us. You see, this woman could not have a healing unless Jesus became weak. It was through his weakness that she became strong. But this is the whole dynamic of how the gospel works. This is the whole dynamic of how your relationship with God works. Jesus became weak so that we could become strong. On the cross, he bore your sin. He bore your shame. He bore your guilt before God. He took your place. He became weak so that in him, you can become strong. You can have life with God when you trust in him, when you do what Jairus had to do. Look at him, trust in him, and believe. And because Jesus was willing to go to the cross for you, because Jesus was willing to suffer everything for you. Do you know what that means? It means he's not going to forsake you in these lesser times. He's not going to forsake you in these struggles we go through. If he was willing to walk through the cross for you, he's going to walk through this with you as well. So Jesus was willing to become weak so that you could become strong. Now, the second thing we see in this text about how we can be sure of this, that he will give more than we planned on receiving, even in a season like this, has to do with what Jesus spoke to the little girl. There's a reason why Mark puts that phrase in Aramaic, Talitha Kaum, because he wanted us to see, this is important, pay attention. He gives us the words and then the translation. The reason has to do with the meaning of the words. The Aramaic word Talitha, it was translated in our text as little girl, and that's literally what it means. It means little girl, but that doesn't really catch the nuance and the essence of it, because this was a diminutive term. It's something that Jairus would have said to his own little daughter when he would address her tenderly. So Talitha is really more accurately translated as sweetheart, sweetie, honey. It's a very endearing term. It's almost like a pet name. So Jesus approaches her and he says, Talitha, sweetheart. And then he says to her, Kum, which is an Aramaic word, which doesn't mean be resurrected. It's what a parent would say to his little girl when it's time for her to wake up in the morning. So Jesus comes to her and he takes her by the hand and he says, Talitha Kum, which means sweetheart, it's time to get up. And she did. And he goes to this woman who's been suffering. And he says to her, daughter, your faith has healed you. And it had. And here's what this tells us about Jesus. If the God of that kind of power, that he can heal a woman who's sick, that kind of power that he can raise a girl from death to life just as easily as he would wake her up in the morning, coupled with that kind of tenderness that he would take her by the hand and say, sweetheart, it's time to get up. If that kind of God is with you, what that means is we're going to be okay. It means you're going to be okay. Considering the power and the love of Jesus, you can trust him in uncertain times. Considering that kind of power and that kind of love, the one who became weak so that you could become strong, we're going to be okay. Nobody knows how long this is going to take. Nobody knows what the cost is going to be. But in the end, Jesus gives more than you planned to receive. If the one who brought this little girl through darkness so that even death was a servant to her, you're going to be okay in this. Now, last thing before I'm done today, I want to talk a little bit about how we in a community respond to something like this. In Ephesians chapter 5, we're told to make the most of every opportunity because the days are evil, to be a brighter light when the world around us grows even darker. And while a pandemic is certainly unprecedented in our generation like this, it's not unprecedented in the history of the world, and it's not unprecedented in the history of the church. So I was doing some reading this week, and in 1527, think about that, in 1527, there was a Protestant minister by the name of John Huss. And the bubonic plague had resurfaced in Europe in the 1300s. It's estimated that it killed about half of Europe's population, about 200 million people globally. And it had returned, and it was advancing in Germany. And so this Protestant minister sent Martin Luther a letter. And he asked him, what do we do when we see the black plague coming? Is it okay to run away and hide from it? And here's what Luther wrote in response, and I think this is so helpful for us today for guidance. Here's what Luther said he would do. He said, I shall ask God to protect us. I shall ask God mercifully to protect us. The first thing I'm going to do, Luther said, when the plague comes back to Germany, I'm going to get on my knees and I'm going to pray. That's the number one thing to do. I'm going to ask God to be merciful to us. I will pray. Then I shall dot, dot, dot. Now, what do you think Luther would do? Okay, I said my prayers. The plague is coming. What's he going to do second? Here's the answer. Then I shall greatly increaseth my supply of toilet paper. Who knew, right? No, that's not actually what he said. He didn't increase his supply of toilet paper. Here's what he said. Then I shall fumigate, help purify the air, administer medicine, and take it. This is so timely, I shall avoid places and persons where my presence is not needed in order not to become contaminated and thus perchance inflict and pollute others and so cause their death as a result of my negligence. If God should wish to take me, he will surely find me, and I will have done what he has expected of me. So I am not responsible for either my own death or the death of others. If my neighbor needs me, however, I shall not avoid place or person, but will go freely. See, this is such a God-fearing faith, because it is neither brash nor foolhardy and does not tempt God. So what do we do when there's a pandemic and there's not much we can do? Here's what I want you to take away today. Number one, live wisely. Live wisely. Do what the experts say we should do in order to be healthy as a society. Live wisely. Number two, love greatly. Who in your neighborhood needs help? Are there people who need you to run to the store for them or just need help with chores? Whatever you can do to help someone, love them greatly. And then finally, take Jesus by the hand. And it's going to be okay. Let's pray. Father, we're thankful that Mark wrote down this amazing encounter that two people had with Jesus during his ministry. And I'm thankful that we could spend time today from remote locations, looking at your word together, worshiping you together, and exploring what we should do during this time of incredible uncertainty. Father, while it's uncertain to us, none of this is uncertain to you. You know the end from the beginning, and you know all things, and you know where this is leading. So we thank you that you are our refuge and our strength. You are the ever-present help in times of trouble. So rather than letting fear and selfishness creep into our hearts, let us be people of boldness, who love to serve others, and let us be people of wisdom who cherish the gift of life you gave to us and to the people all around us. We ask for your mercy, not just here at home, but around the world. May this be a time where your name is lifted up and more lives and eternities are changed. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I want to talk to you for a minute about what's coming up over the next few weeks at Hope and how long it is till we can gather again. The honest answer is right now, nobody knows except for God, and he hasn't told us. We do know that the school districts throughout the state are closed at least until April 6th. So realistically speaking, I'm going to guess that the earliest we can gather again in person would be on Easter Sunday. It's entirely possible, however, that this lasts longer. We're just going to ride it out. It is safe to say that for the next 2 weeks at least, we'll be right here online rather than gathering in person. We want to keep you updated on how you can find us and stay up to date with everything going on at Hope Church. So to do that, make sure you're following our social media channels. Follow us on Facebook or on Instagram. We'll put all of our updates on those channels. Also, if you go to our website, hopelakecountry.com, scroll down to the bottom at the footer, there's a place where you can enter your email address. If you trust us with your email address, we will only use it to send you information on what's going on at Hope so that you are in the loop, because we don't want you to miss out, because we believe this is a critical time to connect with God and be in prayer before his throne. Last thing then, before I turn it over to Nathan for one final song, for those of you who consider Hope to be your church, I want you to know something. The reason why in only 3 days we could launch a completely online service is because of your financial support for our mission of changing lives and changing eternities. And during this season of uncertainty, we don't want to back down and we don't want to coast. We're not going to say, well, I guess we can't gather, so we'll just have a lazy few weeks. Entirely the opposite. You see, we think that the light of the church and the light of the gospel shines most brightly when the world around us is at its darkness. And throughout history, we've seen the kingdom of God change the most people's lives and eternities in seasons of uncertainty and fear, which means we think that this season is an opportunity to reach more people and change more lives and eternities than ever before. And we want to make sure we are resourced to grab every opportunity that's going to come along over the next few weeks and months. So for those of you who either give in person and for those of you who don't financially support the mission of Hope yet, I'm asking you very specifically to consider to begin giving to Hope digitally and support our ministry digitally so that we can continue to go forward. There's a few ways to do that. There's a link in the chat box that you can click on our Facebook page, and you can give digitally that way. You can go to your own bank and go to your bill pay and set us up as a payee through your bank and automate your payments or your giving that way. And that just allows us to make the most difference at a time when our community and our world need it the most. So thank you for partnering with us to make a difference and be here this morning for so many people. And that's all I have to say. I'm going to invite Nathan back out to close us out with a song.
Let's keep worshiping together. Let's sing. You unravel me with a melody. Surround me with the song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. And I'm no longer a slave to fear, as I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear, 'cause I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Father, I am. Thank you so much for being online and worshiping with us today. Remember to stay tuned to our Facebook page, our Instagram channel. Stay up to date on our website, hopelakecountry.com. We'll see you guys online next week.